Hi, Julia.
Hi, Aya. How are you doing this evening?
I'm doing very well considering that the whole world has gone kind of crazy.
It's
How about you?
ridiculous. I'm like, I stayed up late the first night, but I'm like, oh, okay, so we're not going to have an answer. So I guess I'm going to stop looking because it's undetermined, I guess.
Right. Yeah, some of my libertarian friends suddenly remembered that way back when the Constitution provided for the person who got the second highest number of votes to be a vice president. And they were so interested in that, but they didn't remember any of the details. In fact, they didn't remember that Alexander Hamilton was not running for any office during the presidential election of 1800. I think too many people watched that musical and they think that Hamilton was much more important than he actually was.
No, he was just in charge of like the federal, he was the Federal Reserve. He wanted to federalize the banking. That was what he was.
Well, he was involved in everything, but he couldn't run for president because he wasn't a natural born
Oh,
citizen.
yes, that's true. He was
And
born in like the
so,
Caribbean, I believe, right? Barbados or
the Indies, I
the
believe. Yeah.
Indies, okay.
Yeah. Anyway, he was not a nat he was not in line for the presidency. I'm sure he could have gotten it. But he wasn't eligible, and that might have been part of the reason he had such a big chip on his shoulder. But anyway, I thought that. Oh, do we have a comment?
Somebody said, Derek Stra Robot said, just found out people born in 1800 are still voting. No, that's funny. We're talking about this election 1800 because it's very pertinent. Like, if you think about what's happening now and the debacle with many elections in the recent years, maybe how we used to do it was a better solution, you know?
Yeah, no, I know what he's talking about though. One of my Facebook friends went and looked at the voting rolls because you can actually look at some of these things. They are online. People, I don't remember if it was in Michigan or Wisconsin. It was a roll of people, and you could actually arrange the people voting in the election by date of birth. So if you wanted to say, well, who's the oldest person who's voting in this election? You could do that, say the earliest date of birth. And they found that people who were born in 1800 were on the rolls to vote.
Oh, interesting. Okay, that's interesting. I haven't been keeping up on that. So that is wow.
Yeah,
Good.
but that was not me. I didn't research that, so you don't have to take my word for it. You can go online and check that out. But for the time being, we're going to talk about that election of 1800. And what I'm trying to do currently, Julia, you can keep talking about it, but right now I want to share on Twitter. What we're doing.
Okay, so the presidential election of 1800 was very fascinating because you had one candidate who had a higher number of votes, and then the second candidate, did he not end up being vice president? So I would really like to share the article right now, Aya, but I'm not sure if I'll wait on that, I
I'm
guess.
just gonna share on Twitter and then I'll
Okay.
be ready.
Okay, so if you are interested, like I'm going to in the before we share it, I'm just going to share the link to the article.
Okay.
Just so people can see it, and because I wanted to kind of just have everybody, if they would like to look at it, just so they can see the
Okay.
article that Aya wrote about it.
Are you putting that in chat right now?
I was going to put it in the public chat so they could look at it.
That would be good. Yeah.
Yeah, I was just thinking that would be. I'm going to do it on YouTube though, because it's not really. One of the limitations of StreamYard is it doesn't always let me do that for some reason. That's weird. But anyway.
You're not able to get into the chat?
Into the public chat. It wasn't letting me share something in the public chat, but that's okay. I have a workaround.
Okay, hold on. I should be able to share it.
Let's see.
Let's see. I think I copied it.
Okay, there we go.
Yeah, and I can even share it here. So if anybody
wants. Oh, yes. So they could. So I just find it the most fascinating election because everybody really loves Thomas Jefferson. And yes, I know he had a wonderful library and he was basically the forerunner of the Library of Congress. I was watching a really great documentary and reading about that the other day. But, you know, there were other people that supported other candidates. And would it not be a better solution to go back to how the Constitution, like, set this out, that the candidate with the second largest number of votes could be? I mean, wouldn't that be a better system, Aya?
I think it would. And I would like to also discuss what the solution to the little glitch that they encountered during the election of 1800 would be, because I don't think the solution is changing it so that you elect the vice president and the president together and they're running mates. I don't think that's the solution, but I don't think they should have had two votes. I think they should have had one vote, and then they should have voted really for the person they wanted to win. And then the person with the second largest number of votes, who might not have been from their party at all, should have been the vice president. And so in an election such as ours right now, what would happen is that if we have, for some reason, Donald Trump and Joe Biden as the two people with the highest number of votes for president, one of them would get to be president and the other would get to be vice president. And that would keep the country from tearing itself apart, because whether you like the one or the other, they would still be there and they would be powerful and they would also be a symbol of leadership. I personally don't like either one of them.
Yeah, that's one thing I'm just like,
yeah, so it wouldn't solve all the world's problems. I'm not saying it would get you necessarily a good president, but it would solve this problem that right now people are tearing each other apart and are ready to go into civil war over election.
Yeah, over the election. Oh, yes, there was a story I do have to share about that. So I took the bus this morning. It's in front of the VA hospital. This man said, yeah, he goes, there was a fight at the VA hospital this morning because I guess like he went to, get a COVID test. And he said people were fighting, like they were pushing each other in line and the police had to come. And I said, well, why are they fighting over a test? Like there's tons of testing centers. Like it's really easy to get a COVID test if you want to in California. They make it sound hard, but lately actually there's all these testing centers now in my area anyway. I don't know about other places, but I guess he said they were fighting. It was like politically related. They said something political to each other and they were getting like in a fist fight and the police were involved. I was like, oh, okay, this is crazy. I'm like over two candidates that I don't think either one are that great, but you know, divide and conquer politics. They love to keep the country divided. And you have to think about, oh, my favorite picture of Bill Clinton and Hillary Clinton at Donald Trump's wedding. I mean, it's different people this time around, but it's the same idea. Are we really going to fight over all these reigning, like, dynasties, these families that have held some position of power in America? You know, behind closed doors, they might hate each other to some degree, but do they?
Yeah.
They all have very similar policies on healthcare and many different issues.
Yes. So they might be playing good cop, bad cop. Now, Derek Starova had a comment to make. It is on point. He said Aaron Burr killed Alexander Hamilton. Aaron Burr was the vice president of Thomas Jefferson. Yes, all of that is correct. But do you know why Aaron Burr had to kill Alexander Hamilton? And do you know how Aaron Burr got to be vice president under Thomas Jefferson? So this is what our story is going to be. And Julia, it might be a good time to share the article now.
Okay, let me go ahead and go into screen share.
And I will start out by reading parts of it. And then if we have comments, please interrupt me so that we know what those comments are, because I don't always.
Can you see the screen now, Aya? Is it sharing?
Okay, hold on. I think we have one more comment. What did he say? It's been going on since the beginning of time. Okay. All right. Yeah, I'll let you screen share now. Okay.
Okay.
Here we go. So this is my Theodosia and the Pirates blog. And I wrote it to help to publicize Theodosia and the Pirates, which is a book really dedicated to the memory of Aaron Burr and Jean Lafitte. But in any event, this was written on September 9th, 2015, and it's my article about the presidential election of 1800. Even though the framers of the Constitution did not make any mention of political parties, the party system emerged very early on in the history of American politics. And by the fourth quadrennial presidential election, two parties dominated the scene: the Federalists, whose leaders were John Adams and Alexander Hamilton, and the Democratic Republicans, led by Thomas Jefferson and Aaron Burr. Because the framers of the Constitution did not anticipate the rise of political parties, they provided that each member of the Electoral College could cast two votes for president, and that the person with the highest number of votes would be the new president, and the person with the second highest number of votes would be the new vice president. The reasoning behind this rule was that it would maximize the possibility that a person with a majority of national support would be elected president. When people vote by the party and not by the person, the possibility of getting a majority is much greater, as electors never even consider voting for people that the major parties have not thrown their support behind. It was thus that in 1800, the incumbent president was John Adams, and Thomas Jefferson was his rival as a Democratic Republican. Julia, at this point, would you like to share the picture that goes there?
Oh, sure. Let me do that. I'm going to just right click so we can open up the image. Okay, so let me make it nice and big. Okay. So we have the Federalists for President John Adams of Massachusetts, and we have Charles Cotesworth Pinckney, and then we have the Democratic Republicans, which is Thomas Jefferson, President Aaron Burr, Vice VP.
Right. So they created their own tickets as if, you know, it was the way it is now. But in fact, all of these people were running for president, you know, because there were two votes that could be cast.
Yeah. I just think, like, not to interrupt you, but I was thinking, everybody thinks this election, oh, there were only two people, but there were actually five other people running, but they weren't on every state ballot. Interesting, you know, it's like, I think you should be allowed to be on the ballot, the national ballot, but that's another story for another day.
Right. But any one of these four men could have been elected president if he had gotten the highest number of, you know, electoral college votes.
Mm-hmm.
So it wasn't necessarily that it would be John Adams or necessarily that it would be Thomas Jefferson who would be president, because that's not what the Constitution provided for.
No, it did not. It was amended later on to change the way that we elect the president. I don't think that amendment was for the better, right?
No, it was not, you know, because this is what gets us into this mess that we're in right now. Okay, because really, it is quite possible that Joe Biden's running mate is going to be doing all of the running.
Oh, yes. Okay, like honestly, okay. Not to go back to that, but that was my whole thing, my whole concern about. I don't love Donald Trump, but I have a lot of concerns about Joe Biden. I don't really feel like he is equipped to be president. And he says, well, I won all the primaries, but if we remember right, if we look back in time, nobody was really voting in primaries due to the pandemic. And all of a sudden he's like, I'm the nominee, but he was calling himself the nominee, and people were going around calling him the nominee before they even had a convention. So, anyway, that's neither here nor there. I just find it interesting. And then, oh, Kamala Harris, like who people thought was really, they thought she was a little too radical, a little too left-leaning. All of a sudden, she's his VP. It's interesting. I think there's a reason for that because the Democratic Party. They've been wanting to go away from being centrist, like under Clinton. Clinton really prided himself on being a centrist. But it seems like now, like they're going more towards the socialist dynamic. And I have grave concerns. Like, look, I don't love Donald Trump, but and I don't want to turn this into a food fight, but I have grave concerns about this future presidency. I don't think that's the best thing for our country, but hey, everybody that voted for them seemed to think it's lovely. So I don't know.
Yeah, so Derek says that he likes Tulsi, you know, Tulsi Gabbard.
Yeah, I like Tulsi too. I mean, she was a veteran. She was a pretty interesting person, right?
Yeah, right, absolutely. But it now we have you know, we have these running mates, and if anything happens to Joe Biden after the election, or if it's determined that he's senile, or any, you know, comes down with cognitive impairment, then she's going to end up taking over, and nobody's voting for her for president. So it makes more sense, for instance, if let's say, you know, either way, whether Donald Trump is elected president or Joe Biden is elected president, and Donald Trump gets the second highest number of electoral college votes. Okay, and if anything happens to Joe Biden, Donald Trump takes over. You know, that's how it was supposed to work. It
Yeah.
wasn't supposed to be that, for instance, that Charles Pinckney guy that nobody has ever heard of, who was the running mate of Adams. Well, you know, I don't. The reason nobody remembers that Hamilton wasn't running with Adams is because Hamilton is a famous guy, but Pinckney, nobody knows who that is. What
No,
is
I mean, I vaguely remember them talking about his family, but that's really obscure. You have to really dig into that. That's not general knowledge.
right? So does it make sense that that guy, the only reason the Federalists were voting for him is because Adams decided this guy is from South Carolina and we need a Southerner because we always have to balance our Northerners and our Southerners on the ticket. And so that's why he's on there, and people are only voting for him because they're supporting Adams.
It doesn't really make any sense, but it sounds like they wanted to present like, oh, this united front, and what a great idea. Like it deviates from what our Constitution just stated, but why not? Like, let's change it, you know, because we have a better idea. No, you didn't have a better idea. You created havoc in many elections to come, like 1824, 2000. I can just think of it. It would have been so much better if we had just stayed with the original plan on this particular thing, I say.
Okay, so let me keep reading underneath the picture. In
Okay.
preparation for the election, each of the two major parties had a plan and a ticket. Despite the fact that the Constitution expected each candidate to run on his own and for the second runner-up to be vice president, that is not at all how the major players in the election of 1800 organize themselves. Each party had a presidential candidate and a chosen running mate. John Adams chose Charles Coates Pinckney of South Carolina as his running mate. He could not have chosen Alexander Hamilton because Hamilton was foreign born and thus ineligible to hold the office of president. Thomas Jefferson chose Aaron Burr of New York as his running mate. Notice that they tried to keep things even between the North and the South. The presidential candidate from the North, Adams, chose a Southerner for his running mate. The presidential candidate from the South, Thomas Jefferson, chose a Northerner for his running mate, but make no mistake about it. Despite the provisions in the Constitution, there was a presidential ticket for each party that included a presidential and a vice presidential candidate. And in order to make sure that the right guy wound up president from their own slate, each party instructed one of their electors to vote against the vice presidential candidate of their choice, lest he get the exact same number as the presidential candidate. So let's take a break from the article for a minute and talk about this.
Do you want me to go out of sharing while we talk about that?
Yeah, let's go out of sharing. And, you know, do we have any more comments here?
I just see that Derek had made a few comments, but that's great. I'm glad that we have some people that are aware of the history. So kudos to that.
Yeah. So here's the thing. They were already working against the constitutional provision, and they were doing this by instructing one of their electors not to vote for a candidate that they wanted to support. What do you think about that? Isn't that crazy?
That's crazy, and I don't think that's what should have happened, but this is the problem. I think the Constitution was really well thought out, but it sounds like, oh, once the country starts and people are in power, they start thinking, well, I have a better idea. Why don't we do it this way? But there's a lot of crazy things when it comes to politics that are not sound. Like, okay, in the business world, if they want to get something done, they can get it shipped overnight. They can take care of it. But when it comes to our elections, oh boy, look at these messes we have. So,
yeah, you know, in a way, to me, a good analogy for a presidential election is a beauty pageant. Okay. You know, so in the beauty pageant, we have all these beautiful women and we want to find which one is the most beautiful. But in the event that something happens to her, there's the second runner-up.
Yeah.
And the second runner-up is also a very beautiful woman. And she is to take over in case anything were to happen to, you know, the beauty pageant winner. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Now, we don't go around saying, hey, why don't we run this woman as beauty pageant winner, you know, the queen or the... What do they call that? The person, Miss America, whatever.
Yeah, Miss America, Miss World, Miss Brazil, whatever, Miss Africa.
Okay, so they don't go with a running mate. They don't go with, Miss South Carolina is running for Miss America and Miss West Virginia is her running mate. She's going to be the second runner up. We don't do it that way, do we?
No, we don't.
It would be pretty silly if we did that, right?
It was pretty silly.
Okay, so here's the thing. In the beauty pageant, I don't think they cast two votes. I don't think they choose one person for first runner-up and one person for the winner. They just decide... you know, they just cast one vote and then somebody ends up being the second highest number of votes, right?
Yeah.
Isn't that how it works?
That's how it works. I mean, that's actually how California has gone back to doing like their elections, like where it's not even like based on having two different political, it was like the top two, although the way they did it wasn't quite the same.
No. I think ranked choice is not the same as what I'm talking about either. A lot of people will come back and say, oh, what you're talking about is ranked choice. But with ranked choice, people get to rank their choices. And that's not. So ranked choice would be exactly like this. Oh, I this is my first choice, this is my second choice. There shouldn't be a second choice. People should vote one time. The electors
should just one. Yeah, one vote.
See how different that would be?
It's completely different, yes.
Yeah.
But the argument is that the thought is they feel like it's going back. That was just the rationale behind the legislation.
Yeah, no, I went to libertarian conventions where people were talking about ranked choice. And I could tell it wasn't really what I wanted. But it took me a while to think why it wasn't what I wanted. It looks like
I'm glad you think about these things, Aya, because we need you to think about it. It's so good that you thought. So that's a good point.
I think we've got another comment. Okay. So he says, really interested in this. I remember there was some drama or issues, but I don't remember the details. Okay. Well, we're going to go on into the drama and the issues. So let's go back to the article.
Okay. Going back in.
Okay. So we're at the part where it starts, but in 1800, something went wrong. Okay. Can you find that part?
Sure. Yeah. Do you want me to keep reading or are you going to read it?
I'll keep reading for a little while.
Okay. I see it right here.
Okay. So, but in 1800, something went wrong. Okay. I guess I need to authorize you there. Okay. Now we can see it. Things did not go as planned at party headquarters. The person on the Democratic-Republican side who had been instructed to vote against Aaron Burr forgot or changed his mind, and Jefferson and Burr tied for president, each with 73 electoral votes. In the Federalist Party, Hamilton and Adams were not acting in unison, which may be one of the reasons why the Federalists lost their hold on the presidency. Okay, so apparently the Democratic Republicans were acting in unison except for one person, but the Federalists were not even acting in unison at all.
No, I think they were kind of falling apart at that point. I think there were many divisions among the Federalists, were there not, by early 1800?
Right. So we're going to talk about the issues in the election. The issues in the election centered on the Federalist support of England against France, which resulted in the use of the Neutrality Act to prevent American privateers from serving the French interests while the American government was engaged in a quasi-war with France. Now, do you know what a quasi-war is, Julia?
It's like a war that's not an official war, but it's a war that's being fought.
Right. Yeah. So it's an undeclared war. It's like Vietnam, right?
Yeah. But, you know, there are a lot of undeclared wars. Like, look, in Africa, there have been some wars that are just like tribal wars that have been going on for decades. And they're not exactly official, but it's gone on. It's happened, you know, in history.
Well, I mean, in the United States, we have a particular way. We're not allowed to wage war. The government is not allowed to wage war.
No,
unless it's declared. Whereas the citizens under the original Constitution were allowed to wage war without permission from the government. But all of that changed with the passage of the Neutrality Act and then the Logan Act. Mm-hmm. Okay? Because before, citizens were allowed to wage war. They were also allowed to sue for peace. They were allowed to negotiate for peace. But after the passage of the Neutrality Act and of the Logan Act, they were no longer able to do this, and the government had a monopoly on war. Okay?
Yeah.
But I guess Adams or at least the Federalists, I'm not sure whether this started under Washington, but Adams was definitely into wars that were undeclared.
Oh, yeah. He was definitely that's kind of his great children. He was an interesting character. Oh, yeah.
He was on the British side, even though the French actually helped the United States to beat the British, you know, in the Revolutionary War.
Yeah, so, I feel like this was the thing. I think that the Americans accepted the French help because they needed to, but I think many people still maintain their loyalties. It's an interesting, because think about it. We were so newly independent and people are still very tied. It's just interesting. It's not right, but that's reality. Like, and look, we ended up having such a strong relationship with Britain after the War of 1812. We're like, oh, okay, you tried to reinvade us, but okay, we're going to be the strongest allies after that. And then look at Churchill and how.
That was all terribly wrong. And that's part of what was done to Jean Lafitte. But we're getting ahead of ourselves. So
no, what I'm trying to say is we've always had this very dysfunctional close relationship with the British due to many Americans having British ancestry and British roots, even though they should have their own allegiance to their country. So it's not surprising. That's what I'm trying to convey.
Right. Yeah. But not everybody was like that. Adams was. Okay.
Yeah.
All of these were highly unpopular measures, which is why the Democratic Republicans were the clear winners. But while everybody was tired of the tyranny of the Adams administration, by the way, including the Alien Sedition Acts.
Oh, yes.
which were passed in order to make sure that people did not complain about the quasi-war. So that's why the Democratic Republicans were winning. But while everybody was tired of the tyranny of the Adams administration, and most Americans did not want to be satellites of England, there was also concern that Thomas Jefferson might be a Jacobin and that his presidency might result in a loss of property rights, as was suffered by the bourgeoisie under the French Revolution. So they were afraid that Thomas Jefferson was a little too socialist, you know?
Yeah, I know they were afraid of that, but he really wasn't. I mean, he loved to read. He was the American ambassador, and I think that they were overreaching on some of that. Like, I know there was a fear, but that was never the case. He was landed gentry in many ways. No.
Yes, yeah, but then he later took away some land, on the river, saying it belongs to the people, you know. So, but that's, that's going on. Yeah, I'm not saying Thomas Jefferson didn't believe in private property at all, but there were times when he sounded a little bit like a French revolutionary.
Yeah, he did, but he was an eclectic man. I mean, did you know he had a Quran? Like, he read everything. Like, he had many ideas. So I think he just was exposed to many ideas and people got the wrong impression of him. That's my take on it.
Okay. Anyway, that's why certain people, some of them Federalists, were campaigning behind closed doors to make Aaron Burr the president and Thomas Jefferson the vice president. So you see, at this point, the Federalists gave up on getting their candidates elected, but they said, oh, well, you know, Aaron Burr seems so much more reasonable than Thomas Jefferson. You know, we don't think Aaron Burr would, you know, end up taking our property. So maybe we should make him president. So, and the runoff election, you know, after the tie, that's what was going on.
Mm-hmm.
However, that was not Aaron Burr's doing, and he was an honorable man. He had promised to run with Jefferson as the vice presidential candidate. And though he had a chance to grab the presidency, he did not. He instructed his supporters in the House of Representatives to throw in their votes for Thomas Jefferson in the follow-up election of 1801. At this point, the Federalist supporters of Adams had been voting for Burr, while the faction of the Federalists that Hamilton controlled voted for Jefferson. Abigail Adams, in one of her letters, expressed the thought that Burr would make a pretty good president. So Thomas Jefferson, even though he did win the election, never forgave Burr for almost upstaging him. And the next time he ran for president, he did not choose Burr as a running mate. Another far more permanent result of this election was that the Constitution was amended. No more was the vice president to be the person with the second highest number of votes for president. From now on, vice presidents would be elected separately from presidents, thereby acknowledging the practical power of the political party. Today, most people do not know about any of this. Some say it's a shame we have political parties, since that was not envisioned by the founding fathers. Not envisioned, perhaps, but all the founding fathers who ran for office were involved in political parties. So while they may not have wanted them to exist for the other side, they certainly did use them when they themselves were running. People also do not remember that Burr and Jefferson were running mates on the same political party slate. Some contrarians even remember that the president and vice president were elected in the same election, but they do not remember that in order to get around the rules they themselves had made, founding fathers like Adams and Jefferson instructed their political flunkies to cast one vote for somebody they did not want elected at all, just so there would be a clear presidential winner on their party slate, distinct from the vice presidential winner. The historical facts can be quite astonishing. Sometimes it pays to revisit them. Okay, so we are done with the article. And now we're ready for a discussion. And by the way, our discussion is sponsored by the coldest water. Do we have any more comments while I was reading that?
Okay, so I see Derek mentions Napoleon. I'm just curious, Derek, if you're still here, what did you want to share about Napoleon? I think he's thinking about, you know, the war. Although, yeah, he's talking about war with France. I think that's what he's alluding to. And then we have Real News DFW, voting from the 1800s. Wow, 30 minutes behind. Or maybe 120 years behind instead. I'm just
Could be. Yeah, could be like 220 years behind.
My ballot's lost. Maybe it'll show up 120 years late.
Yeah, that could be. Absolutely. So here's my take on this. After thinking about this and after doing all the research to write my novel, Theodosia and the Pirates, and after being a participant in the Libertarian Party's National Convention in Orlando in 2016, I had an idea. Mm-hmm. And my idea was that in the Libertarian Party, there should be a change in the bylaws. Now, I don't know if you know how the vice presidential nominee and the presidential nominee are selected under the current bylaws. Do you know that, Julia?
For the Libertarian Party, to be 100% honest with you, no, I'm not up on that. So did you want to share that with us?
Yeah, so they are actually selected separately. And while the presidential nominee can tell us, you know, we can tell the general convention who he likes and he endorsed somebody to run for vice president, we are not obliged to vote for that person. We can decide that we want Gary Johnson, say, for the presidential nominee, and then we could choose somebody completely different, like Austin Peterson, for the vice presidential nominee. So that's different from how they do it in the major parties right now.
Mm-hmm.
But the problem is that once you have a majority, the majority tends to follow what a faction of the Libertarian Party wants. Let me see if somebody is saying something. Okay, yeah. Let's see what DFW said. You want to read that?
The VP is President Pro Tem of the Senate. Imagine Hillary stopping debate in the Senate. Would have been the worst that what we went through would have been worse. So he's like, oh my gosh, like, well, but yeah, here's the thing.
Yeah,
We
go
don't
ahead.
love any of them, but it was a way to make people work together because right now you have a divided country because the politicians like that. Okay, they love divide and conquer politics. It's been around, yes, since the Roman Empire, but it's exacerbated in these days. And think about it, if Americans had to work together and force the politicians to work together, you might not love the outcomes, but there'd be a lot less like division.
Right. And secondly, everything, all of the checks and balances in the Constitution are intended to make it hard to pass laws, hard to declare war, hard to do anything. So if we are gridlocked about something, it's better to be gridlocked than to do the wrong thing. And that's why it would be wonderful if we had a president and a vice president who is in charge of the Senate, who don't agree about everything, because you know what? The Democrats have bad plans, the Republicans have bad plans, and if they can prevent each other from doing anything, then we libertarians would be very happy about that.
And then maybe we could focus on civil liberties. Like, okay, the only good thing that kind of came out of this election is that in some places they decided, okay, we're gonna pass propositions where we're gonna decriminalize drug possession, which I actually thought was pretty cool because I don't support people with a drug habit, but they need help. They don't need to be sent to prison. So I would prefer to have libertarian options and just like, why are we prosecuting people? We're focusing on the wrong things, Aya. That's just my opinion.
Right. No. Actually, some of the best results of this year's election have been the decriminalization of drugs in various places. Like I think in Oregon, they completely decriminalized everything. Although I don't know how that would work unless the federal drug laws were also repealed.
Yeah, that's the only issue. It's kind of that way in California too. They know, like, I mean, they'll still prosecute certain people, but I think they're like, they'll help them get into rehab or, they give them an option. I'm not saying that the government should mandate people to go to rehab, but it would be better to recommend these people go to rehab than to send them to prison. Like,
Right.
but I thought that was one of the good things that came out of this election. That's just my thought.
It was definitely the best thing. It has been the best thing so far. But what I would want to do, for the Libertarian Party, and then I want to talk about that, and then I want to talk about what I would want to do with the Constitution. So what I would want to do with the Libertarian Party, because I saw it happen. I saw what happened. Bill Weld was chosen by Gary Johnson to be the vice presidential nominee, his running mate. And Bill Weld was not a libertarian. And so when he was running with Gary Johnson, he was going around saying how Hillary was great. It was pr practically endorsing Hillary while running as the vice presidential nominee of the
I
Libertarian
have
Party.
questions about that. Was he put there? Like, did somebody tell him to infiltrate the Libertarian Party to undermine what they were doing? Like, I kind of wonder because it seems like now, this time around, he's just all, I mean, I don't know exactly what's, but I heard he supports Biden. So it sounds
Yes,
like,
he endorsed Biden.
so basically, I feel like they just put him there. And I felt like Gary Johnson was a really, really good option, but people kept downplaying him. They said, well, we have laws. We have laws that say third parties can't be at presidential debates. There's no law that states that. There's just
Yeah, no. Gary Johnson was a well-intentioned person. He wasn't faking it. But I thought Austin Peterson was a much
was
better.
better. Yeah, of course. I know he was better. He's more articulate, and he's more well versed on history and politics and
So,
folks.
okay, let's say he didn't get number one. He didn't get, the first position. I think that we ought to have in the Libertarian Party bylaws that say that the second runner up in the first vote, not having several different votes or whatever, the second runner up, that person should be the vice presidential nominee, and we don't care what the presidential nominee wants. We don't care what the factions in the Libertarian Party want. That's what the people want, okay? And that's what we should have. Mm-hmm. So for a while there, I was trying to get nominated to the bylaws committee in the Libertarian Party, not for any other reason, but that I just wanted to change that in the bylaws. I wasn't running for office. I wasn't supporting any person who was running for office this year. I didn't care. I just wanted to put that in there.
Yes. Reasonable. But
I didn't even get chosen to be on the bylaws committee. So there goes that. But if I had any influence at all, I would want to do that in the Libertarian Party. And now going to the Constitution of the United States, what I think ought to be done is that the amendment that changed how the vice president is elected should be changed back to very nearly what we had to begin with one exception, that we shouldn't cast two votes. The electors should not get to cast two votes, one for, you know, and then see who gets the most.
Mm-hmm.
They should only get to cast one vote, and whoever comes in second place, that's your vice president.
So I have a loaded question for you, Ida. I know in the past, like, I've toyed with the idea, because I actually thought, like, to me, like, I was really drawn to this idea when it first came up with Ross Perot. And the Democrats used to hate this back then. Ross Perot said, well, we should get rid of the Electoral College. So how do you feel that's an absurd notion? Like, when people, I do find it funny that the Democrats now, when Hillary lost the election due to the Electoral College, all of a sudden they want to abolish it. So what are your thoughts on presidential candidates saying that we should get rid of it?
No, I think the Electoral College is the only thing that saves people who live in rural places from being totally bullied and tyrannized over by people who live in urban places.
Mm-hmm.
So
it's really balances.
A lot of the conflicts in the United States from the very beginning were between agricultural people in the South and, industrial people in the North. And what happens with agriculture is that there's a lower population density. There are fewer people. And because of that, if we just counted the heads and we gave each person one vote, people in the city would always, always, always outvote people in the country. And that's not fair. And
no, definitely not. Yeah.
The founding fathers understood this, and that's why they invented the Electoral College. And it's not all about how many people, it's not about the popular vote, because the state divisions are important. Each state is, you know, a kingdom unto itself.
Yeah.
And
we're just the reasons. Yeah.
Yeah. So this allows a lot more local control, and it allows people in rural areas to have a say. And that's really important, because even if you look at the map, you know, the red blue map.
Yeah.
You can see that in terms of square miles or whatever it is you want to talk about, acres, in terms of the area, everything is almost all red except a blue dot here and a blue dot there and a blue dot there. But the only problem is that most of the people live in those blue dots. That is our problem.
You know, it's interesting though. Well, here's an example, like a big state, California. So people are like, well, 65% of the people voted for Joe Biden, they say. But you have to keep in mind, 35% of the people did vote for Donald Trump. And 35% of California's population is actually higher than many states. So this is just another thought. Like, I know a lot of people really hate Donald Trump, but he still did have a lot of support in California. I just want to throw that out there. Like, yes, there are.
Yeah.
I just kind of want to illustrate that, and that's actually in more rural parts of California, by the way. But this is how our electors work. It's just monopolized by the liberal majority in California, unfortunately, that come from more
No,
urban
it
areas.
yeah, even in those states where we were surprised that they didn't end up, the state didn't end up going red, it went blue. It's because those states had a lot of urban population and they just were able to swing it that way.
Yes, exactly. So we have a lot of good comments, like from Real
Okay.
News. Yeah, he's asking, does anybody know Joe Jorgensen got any electoral votes? I know she only got 1% of the vote. She had a very, and it's due to the pandemic. I think she just didn't really have a chance because look what happened to Gary Johnson. Look what happened to Jill Stein in 2016. This time around, you didn't even know that there was a Green Party candidate. There was one. I mean, I would not have voted for him. He was a total socialist. But anyway, you didn't even know until you look at your ballot and you're like, oh, okay, there's all these people running that we didn't know about.
Okay, and Derek said, I thought Kanye West would have been way more popular. Well, he wasn't on the ballot in every state. What states was he on the ballot in?
He ended up being in California, but here's the problem with Kanye West. He needs to take a stand. If he says, I'm going to run for president, people started making a campaign for him in July, and then he was waffling. He's like, oh, I changed my mind. And then he's like, no, I'm coming back. You have to, if you're saying that you want to do something, he actually alienated a lot of people, like people that would have got behind him. Like if he had been like really serious about it, which I think you should be somewhat serious if you're going to make that statement, but he waffled, so that's why he lost support and he wasn't really popular because he wasn't taking it seriously, honestly.
Okay. Well, I mean, but he wasn't on every ballot, right?
No, but he ended up in California because you can get a petition, get somebody on the ballot, like, because you can get so many signatures here. So here in California, yes. Other states, I don't know. I'd have to look to see how many other states he was on the ballot in. But we had some candidates that Florida didn't have. They had some presidential candidates that we didn't have, which I thought was interesting. You can write in who you want.
Right. Yeah. Unfortunately, what I feel is I'm totally disenfranchised. So let's talk about the people who don't vote. So there are people, even mathematicians, on my Facebook feed who are saying, well, don't you understand that your vote is very important? If you don't vote, you can't complain and every vote counts. It's actually not the case. You can look at what happens in your state. I looked at what happens in my state. It wouldn't matter what I voted for. I would be outvoted in my precinct. There would be, I'm completely disenfranchised. I don't feel that anything that I do would make a difference. So my question is, why does anybody else feel that what they're doing makes a difference? Am I different from everybody else?
I don't think so. I think a lot of people in this election, unless they were just so rabid and tribal into certain political party interests, I think there were a lot of people that did abstain. We're just not hearing those voices because right now you have MSNBC and CNN, they're pro Biden, and then you have Fox News, which is pro Trump, but you don't hear about, you have to go online and read and dig. There's many people that are independents that said this was a horrible election. There were no good choices and they felt disenfranchised. I voted down ballot, but my ballot got lost. So what was the point? Where's my
Right.
ballot? It's gone bye-bye. And I put it in an official city drop box, but I tracked it and it didn't end up where it was supposed to be. And I'm not the only one. Like a lot of people's ballots, like they're just gone. Like, where are they?
Okay, so we have something from Real News DFW. Listening at double speed, now about 10 minutes behind. Should the feds be in the drug business to begin with? Common good has been turned into a sneaky tool to centralize power. No, of course they shouldn't be in the
No,
drug.
and you know what? Do you want the government legislating your morality? I don't, because let people decide. Like, they can go to church, they can, I don't know, join a cult if they want somebody to legislate their morality. But do I want the state to legislate? No. It's a bad choice, and they use it as a reason to seize animals from people, all sorts of like unjust wrongs, you know?
Okay, and he says that the debate commission is mostly Democrats, so they hate competition more than the Republican Party. What do you think about that, Julia?
Because I don't hear a lot of Republicans say, yeah, come on. They were kind of rude to Ron Paul. Ron Paul,
Yeah,
that
they were terrible to him.
Ron Paul is great. Okay. Ron Paul is the only person who knows what's happening in Iran and Syria. Like, he's very well versed in world politics. He helped to negotiate the release of our embassy people in 19. People don't give him enough credit, but yet they were so rude to him in the 2012 like Republican debates. They were rude to him.
Yeah, no, they were terrible. They didn't actually let him speak at the convention.
Yeah.
That isn't that crazy?
That's crazy because they knew that he was well versed on things, and it's unfortunate, but you know.
He says Ross Perot brought us a second Billy Clinton term. He hated the Bush family.
Ross Perot just wanted to be president. He was kind of a zany guy, and he really believed in himself, and he thought that he was kind of fun, but he probably had an overinflated ego, but I don't think it had anything to, you know, the Bushes were actually rude to him. They said that they were gonna go to his daughter's wedding and harass his daughter, so I don't think we have any. Yeah, the Bushes are not saints in that one either.
Yeah. And Real News DFW says Ross Perot did lead the Tea Party. Derek said that he agreed with us about Ron Paul not being treated well. And he says, Real News says, funny though, Tea Party started as a libertarian idea.
To
Well,
some degree, yeah. I think the people kind of have forgotten about them. Like, I don't know, are they even around? Like, I know they you have some Tea Party meetings, but it seemed like they were just a thing of the early 2010s. Like, is it still a thing anymore?
it's not a thing, and people have forgotten about taxation. I mean, that's not even the issue right now. If Biden wins, for instance, what I'm afraid.
Our economy is going to be so ruined. Like, I know people really hate Donald Trump, but you know, he has deregulated things to some degree to where our unemployment dropped to 1%, okay? Before the pandemic, okay? I'm not talking pre-pandemic. There was a Bloomberg article talking about how good the economy was, and I could see it. Everybody knew it. Like, not everything bad was, there wasn't everything horrible under Trump. He had horrible policies on immigration. I don't agree with his immigration policies or like some of his off-color comments, but the economy was doing pretty good. Honestly, it just was.
Yeah. And lately he's been negotiating peace in the Middle East. Did you see how many countries?
Yeah, he has been doing that, and I think he actually did listen to people. Like, I have like a third cousin. She was born in Syria, and she said she didn't like, she actually liked Donald Trump because she felt like he would listen to people that were saying what is happening in Syria, like how they wanted to attack, even though later on he kind of went back on that. But they said he would actually listen to them more than Hillary Clinton, who wanted to go in and create a no-fly zone and all sorts of war-oriented activity.
Right.
So, I mean, I don't think he's a horrible person. I think he's a little unhinged. I don't think he has like a trajectory of thought that's really thought out. I think he changes his mind on certain things a lot. But I do think one of the benefits to a president like him is we've had less regulation and just a stronger, more robust economy. That's kind of what I take away from his presidency. The economy was good.
I don't like Donald Trump. I don't think that he did what he promised about Obamacare, for instance.
No, he's a statist and he was a Democrat too. He was for like basically a different version of socialized medicine. He's not all that different. Him and Biden, what were they saying that was so different during that debate on health care?
So the truth is, I wanted Ron Paul when Ron Paul was running. I wanted Austin Peterson. When Austin Peterson was running, I would have settled for Gary Johnson. I voted for Gary Johnson. But, the next morning when it turned out that Donald Trump had won, I wasn't, as upset as I would have been if Hillary had won. That's the truth. That's just how it is.
Yeah, I wasn't a fan of Hillary. And here's the thing, like this time around, I'm getting a lot of heat from people because I used to be a Democrat, and a lot of people in California are Democrat. And you can't say this, like in California, it's almost like a gag rule. Like I know people who are Republican, okay, and they can't say that they are because they will be ostracized. Like one of my friends says she can't even mention that she's a Republican because she's afraid she might be fired or something. That's scary. I didn't know it was like illegal to have just like a little bit of an opinion, okay? Like any kind of opinion. But yeah, basically, some people are like, yeah, you can't have any kind of political opinion, even if it's just a mild one, if it deviates from, you're allowed to have like a corporate political opinion. And that's kind of what I feel like about Joe Biden and Kamala Harris. I feel like they're kind of corporate Democrat, but I don't know. Like it's kind of weird. It's corp. It feels crony capitalism. It doesn't feel like anything. Like I'm not excited about their presidency, but that's just my
I'm
take.
scared. I'm really scared. There's going to be a mask mandate, a national mask mandate. I'm really scared that that Obamacare stuff will be worse, under them, that we're all going to be paying really high insurance that we won't be able to get out of because otherwise we'll be fined on our taxes.
Which is horrible. And that's not good for the economy. How does that help us? It does not help us.
Okay, Real News DFW said that they were a Ron Paul delegate his last run for office. And I wanted to ask, did you get all the way to the national convention? Because I was also representing Ron Paul, but we didn't get past the district convention, my group, because Santoris won our district. Okay,
Yes,
so
he did take away some regulations. And honestly, the more regulations you have in the economy, the higher the unemployment rate. There is some correlation to that, but people don't get it.
okay, and Derek said, I gave my black friend a Trump hat because he just liked it. He didn't vote Trump and is non-political. And some people tried to beat him up. Really? Seriously?
Yeah, I've been hearing a lot of things that there are some African American people that support Trump. That's their business, but I've heard they get a lot of hate. So I don't know what that's
I
about.
guess
Like,
that's an example of systemic racism, I guess. If somebody If you're black, you're not allowed to have an opinion of your own.
you can have any opinion you want and be any ethnicity you want. It's silly because we're Americans. Like, you can vote for who you want to vote for. I don't care. Yeah.
I mean, they talk about systemic racism, but that's an example of systemic racism on the Democrat side.
Okay, we have to be careful. Like all this stuff, like systemic racism, all these key terms that like popped up all of a sudden. These are all Antifa terms. These are all like kind of socialist terms. Like, why are these becoming mainstream terms? Like, these were terms that like Antifa, they would go to protests and kind of do like domestic terrorism things. Like, is and all of a sudden this is becoming mainstream talk. And I'm not saying there isn't racism. There's a lot of racism in this country, but what about Asian Americans who suffer from racism because of different policies and nobody cares about that? Like, there's all kinds of racism we don't talk about.
Right. Okay, so both Real News DFW and Derek are Ron Paul supporters, each in their own way.
Well, I thought Ron Paul was rational. I just think I don't find anybody rational in this election, and I don't really care what anybody thinks anymore about my opinion, but I'm not going to be pretending to be happy about a Joe Biden presidency because I don't think it feels right to me.
Well, I have to be really careful right now. You know, I'm in a number of Facebook groups. I don't follow the party line of any party, including the Libertarian
Party. Yeah, but that's the whole point of the Libertarian Party, I thought, was that we were all supposed to be for freedom and acceptance of different ideas, I thought, right?
Right. But I'm very scared in certain groups to mention that I am concerned about this election because, you know, if I mention any irregularities at all, any vote not being counted, like yours, for instance.
Yeah, where's my vote? And I'm not afraid to say it because, like, hello, like, transparency, like, I tracked it with the San Bernardino County ballot tracker. Why is it not showing up? Where is it? Like, just tell me. Like, I want to know. I'm not afraid to say it. I'm just not going to talk about it on Facebook because Facebook has a problem right now where, oh, you could share a mainstream article, and there are liberal people, by the way, share mainstream article, and it's vetted, but then there are fact checkers that can go back later and say, oh, this article is not factual, even though it was written by a mainstream source, but the article said something that some fact checkers didn't like, so they put an amendment on there saying, like, that makes the article not visible. You know what I'm talking about, right?
Yeah, I know. I know. I've seen a lot of that stuff. We've allowed ourselves to be policed by these large corporate entities that are running the high-tech stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And because they are corporate entities and not the government, there's a huge debate about whether this is, in fact, any kind of censorship that we have any right to complain about. Why don't we just start our own Facebook? Why don't we go someplace else? But people get their YouTube channels deleted. They have videos deleted. Entire, you know, lives are ruined right now if somebody says the wrong thing.
And it would always seem like an innocuous thing, but we're supposed to have freedom of speech. But at the end of the day, do we entirely have that anymore in 2020? Probably not. I hate to say it. Unfortunately.
Yeah.
I don't want to get people down because I love the idea of American freedom and freedom of speech. But this election raises many question marks for me. That's all.
Yeah. Yeah, well, it would be nice if the next time we have a presidential election, all of the people are running against each other and the second runner-up would be the vice president. I think that would solve a lot of problems. I think right now the people who are very much behind Trump will never accept Biden. The people who are very much behind Biden, and goodness knows why, but they will never accept Trump.
Yep.
And we are teetering toward a civil war.
But, you know, I think there are some people that want this division because who is going to, I guess what we have to look at right now is who is benefiting financially from keeping the country divided? This is the question I'm beginning to ask myself at the end of the day, because it's the most toxic thing, but somebody benefits from it to some degree. So that's my question.
Somebody China. Has an interest.
Yeah, China. There we go. That's what it is at the end of the day. So you have to ask yourself, are any of these politicians really freely of their own free will, Trump or Biden? They're both beholden to China in many respects. Look at their business dealings. Just that's okay. The beginning.
Okay, so at this point, I want to tell you about a series. It's about Korea. My daughter is kind of making fun of me because every time I mention a Korean series that I'm watching, she says, "Oh, are you planning to move to Korea?" And I never was that interested in Korea before, but I think it's because there is a dearth of stuff to watch that's any good. And so every time I watch a Korean series, they show me another Korean series I could watch too. So I'm watching Mr. Sunshine, and it's a historical drama about Korea during the time, I guess, of Teddy Roosevelt or thereabouts. Did you know that there was slavery in Korea?
I have heard about that. Yeah.
So it starts out with this little boy who he and his parents are slaves, and their master sets up against his father so that somebody could get his mother. Anyway, his parents die and he runs off, and he joins an American, an American to take him to the United States. But anyway, it's telling us all about the history of Korea, you know, and all of these foreign nations that had an interest in Korea, such as the United States and Japan.
And yes.
And they were having a discussion, the emperor, or I can't remember if it's an emperor or king, whatever, you know, the guy who was in charge was saying, "I think we should ask Russia to help us."
Oh, yes. Sino-Japanese. Oh, see.
Anyway, yep. The whole thing about everything that's going on in Korea in that series is that all these foreigners, all these foreign powers are attacking Korea or manipulating Korea or exploiting it. And it's not called Korea. It's called something like Joseon. Anyway, I think this is happening to us right now. We are on the down, you know, we're sliding down, and we're about to be exploited, and we are about to be taken over. And so if you want to know the politics of politicians who have to curry favor with foreign governments, that's a good series to watch, even if you're not interested in the specifics of the characters.
It sounds good. I'm going to start watching it. And then I think next week we're going to discuss this, the history and the fictional characters in the series. Is that correct?
Well, I don't know. We might not do it next week. We might have a guest, you know, we might.
That's true. I wasn't sure. That's why I was asking.
I think we need to give ourselves more than 1 week to watch it, because you know how the series are. I've only just started. I'm on the third episode. And they usually have 16, as you pointed out.
Yeah, 16 seems to be their sweet spot. And I was trying to think, like, why do I like these Korean series? I kind of have a thing for Koreans. And then I remembered I had, like, this is totally unrelated, but I had, like, this really cute dentist that was South Korean. I just kind of
Oh, okay.
Yeah, my dentist. My little dentist, like, he was so cute, and he was very awkward, and he was horrible at working on my teeth, but he was very cute. And I don't know, when I watch this series, it kind of reminds me of him. Like, not that it's him, but just I like Koreans. They're fun.
Yeah, and it looks like we have some more comments. Okay, something about France. Okay, France and England, during their lifetime, USA is 1-800. Okay. All right. Anything to say about that, Julia? I really have nothing whatever to say about the number of battles we've won.
Yeah. Well, it's just because they've been countries longer than we have. Like, it's history. Like, it's continuity. Like, we haven't been around as long. But guess what? Americans all can trace their roots back to somewhere else. So it's a little...
Well, you know, as a a person from Israel, I think that all of these countries, including France, are Johnny come latelys.
Yeah, they are. And by the way, too, like, I'm kind of bifurcated because I'm part Lebanese and part English. And, like, I don't know, where do I belong? You can split me up to two different spots.
Okay. And Real News DFW says to Derek, I think that's the Marxist plan in the GND parties and certainly BLM and Antifa.
Well, maybe we should have Carlos come back on one of these days and he can talk a little bit more about that too, because he seems to know a little bit about all that Antifa, having grown, which is interesting because he's Drez and he grew up in Syria, so he kind of can tell, like, he can tell people about, like, what these socialist movements are and why they, you know, I think he has some background knowledge in that.
Yeah, we could certainly do that. But in terms of your question, who is behind this? Who actually benefits from the situation that we're in right now? I think it's definitely China.
Oh yeah, China does. But there are also U.S. corporations that have sponsorship, like connections with China, and they're going to benefit too. So it is definitely business related, government related. But yes, it's all back to China. Like, hello, who's the rising global superstar? It's China. It's not Russia anymore. People, I think Russia wants everybody to think they are, but China is beating them out.
Yeah. Oh, well, the Marxism that we're dealing with is of the sort that it has to do with social credits.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that our commenters here are thinking about old school Marxism. They're thinking about Lenin and Stalin or whatever.
We're talking about like China social credits, where you can't even buy things in the grocery store if you don't have social credits, right?
Right, right, exactly. And where they actually encourage you to be online, but they tell you what to say.
Yeah, like, very interesting.
So when I'm looking at my about, you know, I go into Facebook and I'm looking at how Facebook keeps telling me that the election isn't over yet. You know, it keeps, you know, every time I open it, it has this thing and it says, votes are being counted. The winner of the 2020 U.S. presidential election has not been projected yet. Did I ask you, Facebook?
They keep telling us, like, oh, like, we need them to, oh, because if you posted something on Facebook right now saying, I mean, not that I would, but you could be like, Joe Biden is the winner. Oh, no, you can't say that because Facebook would put a notice.
Yeah, but I mean, if I'm just looking at my feed, I didn't ask it anything.
No, you didn't ask it anything, but it also tells you now what they say now that they want you to share that you voted. They say now that they want you to put like some sort of like thing saying that you support them.
No,
but what if you're not political? And you don't want to do anything political on Facebook and you just wanted to share your dog pictures.
And when BLM were having all of their riots and things, they were asking me to share something about BLM, you know, pro BLM.
That's kind of ridiculous because nobody should have to share something if they don't agree with it.
Yeah.
Like, and you have to ask yourself, well, why would we want to share that when in my city I know what they said. They said that they were going to come up here to Redlands and we have a lot of money and they were going to smash up our stores because, you know, they were going to teach us a lesson and we have a lot of corporate stores up here and like, yeah, let's just do it. But here was the problem. They destroyed a lot of mom and pop shops in San Bernardino that had nothing to do with like what happened to George Floyd or anything. And those businesses were minority owned and they will never come back. How can they afford to? And people just get on this train and like, we're going to do this, we're going to do this, but they should really think about what they're supporting and advocating. The whole thing makes me really sick.
Yeah. So I'm just trying not to be discouraged.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, there will be a tomorrow. Of course, everything won't collapse all at once. But I also don't think that we should agree to everything, you know?
No, we shouldn't agree to everything, but the issue is I think a lot of people will just they change with the winds. Oh, did Facebook tell them today that they should feel that way and this is what makes them a good person? Oh, yeah, they'll post that and they won't think about the implications, but this is what it's a very slippery slope, and that's kind of why sometimes I just disengage with Facebook. If I see a lot of that, I'll be like, okay, well, there we go. I'm just not going to look at you today.
Right. And that's why, I do have another channel in which all I do is paint right now. I mean, you and I used to have conversations about anything also on that other channel, but
Yes.
right now, all I do is paint.
Paint, and that's good. I'm glad that you're painting. I started drawing again, but I was editing videos for my other channel and I got kind of obsessed with that and it spent a lot of time on it. And I think the videos turned out good, but they're probably never going to be viral videos. Although I got a lot of comments, which was interesting. I got lots of comments, but
Good.
barely any views. And I don't feel like the amount of comments I have would usually translate into like 1,000 views on each of those videos a few months ago, but right now they're barely like 150 each. So
Yeah, okay, here's some advice. I don't know, I'm having serious viewership issues too, but maybe sometimes we shouldn't give them more. So what I found is that on a video that used to get 1,000 right away, it wasn't getting it right away, but if I waited a few days, it would get the 1,000. Whereas if I had produced another video and another video and another video, none of those videos would ever get to 1,000.
That's
So
probably true, yeah. So like wait maybe and see.
yeah, I mean, if you feel like if you're inspired to make a new video, I'm not saying don't make it, but maybe don't release it right away.
Yeah, I think I'm gonna wait because I like that advice because I've been a little discouraged with YouTube's metric lately, but it's okay. I don't want to complain. It's just what it is.
Right. So anyway, I think we've covered the election of 1800 and we've talked a little bit about the current election, but not too much.
Yeah, and we've said what we needed to say about that. That's really all I have to say about this current one, to be honest with you. I said everything I have to say about it.
Right. And I feel I'm along for the ride. I would like to stay away from, getting too myopic, too close to the subject. I would like to take a historical perspective on what's going on and try to understand it rather than get angry about it.
That's better, and that's the more intellectually like stimulating way to view it, and that's how we should view it, like as a historian, not as somebody that's immersed in it. Just, oh my gosh, Facebook told me I should support this. I'm gonna go change my frame. Like, come on, people. Like, I like the one lady who says she's just gonna post pictures of her dogs, or when you do art and chickens, because I'm like, you guys are actually posting some political ideas, but it's not like, oh, because Facebook told me to do it.
Right. And occasionally I even talk about food,
Yes, and I like that. So we'll keep doing what we're doing. And if other people want to just do whatever they're told, they might regret one day not thinking why they just did that. I'm just saying, think for yourselves.
Yes. Think for yourselves. And if you want to support a change, how about let's go back to having the vice president be the person who got the second highest number of electoral votes? How about that?
Sounds good.
Okay, Julia, thanks for talking to me about this, and we'll talk again very soon.
Have a good night, Aya.
You too, Julia. Bye-bye.
Bye.